and neither are demands for one of Northern Ireland's most notorious sex scandals to be included. The Kinkora Boys' Home in Belfast witnessed horrendous sex abuse of boys in care. But it's long been haunted by allegations that the abuse was covered up to protect a British intelligence operation spying on loyalists.
Kinkora has become a byword, I think, for allegations of political conspiracy and cover-up, not just of the most heinous forms of child abuse, but also potentially of one of the dirtiest episodes of the so-called Dirty War.
A public inquiry and police investigations have insisted that the abuse in Kinkora was confined to the home and was not part of a wider ring operating outside the hostel. But tonight, Spotlight provides explosive testimony that says there was a sophisticated paedophile ring linked directly to Kinkora.
We went to the hotel and we would be in the lounge and we would have drinks. And there was other gentlemen there. And one of them would ask one of us to go up to the room.
This seems to be new information, and that information needs to be put before the inquiry team.
This is a child abuse scandal that I began investigating over 30 years ago.
Kinkora has raised many questions. How could such corruption of boys in public care go on undetected for so long?
And still, it hasn't given up all its secrets. Kinkora was home to teenage boys in care, about to make the transition from classroom to workplace. But it was a haven for three paedophile care staff. Warden Joe Mains, his deputy Raymond Semple, and House Father William McGrath stood trial and were jailed for sex offences against boys in their care in 1981. When I first began to cover the story, public attention focused on William McGrath, a preacher, an Orangeman, well-connected in unionist circles, and known to leaders like Ian Paisley.
Had you met McGrath before that time? Had you ever met McGrath before? Before 1975 or 1973?
Yes, I had met him when he ran a faith house. He ran a faith house in, I don't know where it was, but somewhere in the other end.
Finnegan.
It's a story of a decades-long scandal, one that continues to this day. A story of horrific abuses perpetrated against young boys and of how the integrity of the state and the unionist establishment was put before protection of young lives. It's a cover-up that dates back to the start of the conflict, but only now is the truth finally beginning to emerge. This is Clint Massey. Today he's speaking out on a period of his life that for years he had kept in the shadows. Clint entered the care system aged 10.
My mother left my father for another guy and I couldn't get on with him. A bad feeling right all round. And somewhere along the line it was decided that I would go into a children's home.
At 16 he was sent to Kinkora. But like so many other abused, he couldn't tell his family about the abuse.
I didn't want my mother to think of bad things that happened to me. I didn't want to put any guilt onto this woman. And up until she died, I always let her believe that I was okay in there. Nobody touched me, nobody done anything to me in there. After my first night there, the next morning, that's when it all started. I was totally stunned by what happened. And I had no comprehension of anything like that. You know, it wasn't in my world, all them things. Getting woken up by this old guy's hand inside your pajamas, that was the shock of my waking up.
Clint recalls feeling powerless to do anything to stop the abuse.
Why did I not resist? You know, why did I not fight back? I couldn't fight back. I mean, this person was officially my guardian. You know, I just could not fight back against him, this all-powerful man.
His abuser was William McGrath, the most violent and prolific paedophile at the hostel.
McGrath continued to rape me right up and to the left.
William McGrath was more powerful than Clint could ever have imagined. In the 60s, there was a power and authority that came from unionists within Orange Lodges, and which McGrath tapped into. The leader of Orange Lodge 1303, he also controlled a shadowy doomsday organisation called Tara.
We recognise that this is total war. We recognise that this will be a long and bitter struggle.
He had been predicting blood on the streets, including on the Shankill, where I first heard him preaching, and that we would have to stand up and fight the cause. What he got was, at least initially, an evangelically led paramilitary group.
Here we see Tara's banners at a religious rally in Belfast, for God and Ireland. Roy Garland was McGrath's second in command in Tara.
We were led to believe there's this big cataclysm coming, but in actual fact, we were creating the problem.
The 1970s began with the violence that appeared to confirm the doomsday McGrath had predicted. The onset of an IRA bombing campaign put Tara on a war footing to defend Ulster. As a result, they attracted the attention of British Army intelligence. In the 1970s, Brian Gemmell was a young undercover Army intelligence captain stationed in Northern Ireland and tasked with running an agent inside Tara to investigate loyalists and in particular McGrath.
William McGrath, according to my source in Tara, claimed to be an agent, maybe that just means an informant, for MI6 and then MI5. But begs the question, what really was Tara? Was it an intelligence gathering organization in the loyalist and Protestant community on behalf of the security service? Or was it a means of achieving some of their political ends? Was it an organization of influence? Was it an organization that could massage events?
What undoubtedly was of interest to British intelligence was the group of unionists who were part of McGrath's circle of influence. He had the ear of the Ulster Unionist Party leaders, like Sir Knox Cunningham, who supported Tara, and Jim Molyneux, both of whom had visited McGrath's house, as well as unionist leaders of the future, Reg Empey, the former Stormont Minister, Nelson McCausland, and John Laird, now Lord Laird, among them. But they didn't yet know about the dark secret Roy Garland had discovered, that McGrath had been abusing boys who had attended evangelical meetings.
I talked to, I reckon, at least a score of young people. This was serious abuse. This man was dangerous in terms of young people and dangerous in terms of politics. I spoke to at least a dozen clergymen, the Orange leaders. I said to the district master, in fact, he said to me, I'll put my cards on the table. I know about this man. A lot of them didn't need to tell them. They knew.
Garland didn't realise it, But complaints of abuse from residents had become an open secret. For nearly two decades, police, social services, and members of the Orange Order, as well as politicians, were being told about sexual abuse in Kinkora. There was a growing sense that the Kinkora staff were either very lucky or were, for some reason, being protected. So you were disappointed with the reaction to
disappointed, not the word. We thought, we'd heard all these stories about the Soviet Union and the lack of freedom and the lack of transparency and so on. And we thought, it's here. It's here in Northern Ireland. And this is allowed to continue. And young kids are being destroyed and have been destroyed for decades.
In the mid-70s, Roy Garland shared his concerns with Brian Gemmell.
What I was wanting from Roy Garland, who does this in Tara? What is Tara? What are their tasks? Just how real is it? How much is this a figment? How much is it a real organisation? And who are the people? In a way, what Roy wanted was to deal with the Kinkora scandal, and it was a kind of quid pro quo. He gave me information, but I agreed, and I was willing, more than willing to do it, I agreed to take up the story of the abuse of boys at Kinkora.
What happened next stunned the young captain. He was summoned by one of the most senior MI5 officers in Northern Ireland. Rather than report the abuse, he was told to drop his interest in Tara and Kinkora, and therefore also McGrath.
I was shocked. I know I'd done a good job. I'd got information on Tara. It wasn't a lot, but this is only the beginning of something. I had dealt with and brought to light something that was potentially criminal behaviour. The line was very clearly, drop this.
The abuse at the boys' home continued for 5 years after MI5 asked Gemmell to drop his investigation. Yet a later police report into